Abdurrahman sir, can you hear me? Abdurrahman
It's time to one. A very good afternoon to the speaker as well as the participants of this 14th session of this AICT sponsored FDP program. So extremely, we are in the last session. So definitely, I hope you will enjoy this session followed by the validatory function. So actually, in our schedule, a separate link have been shared to you to join the validatory function by 4 to 5 p.m. But actually, after discussing with our coordinators for the convenience with the participants, so we thought the session 14 will be combined with the session 15. So the validatory function will be followed by the session 14. The session 14 feedback will be posted in the validatory function itself. And also in the validatory function, you have the quiz also. So I request the participant to be stay along with us in the validatory function till the completion of this FDP program. So it's time to start our session 14. So I welcome you all to this session 14 of this AICT Inspired FDP program. So we have the speaker, Mr. B.A. Hashim, today with us. I think Mr. Hashim sir have joined us. So here is the short bio of our speaker. Mr. B.A. Hashim is an assistant professor in the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering at C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering and Technology. He is currently doing his PhD research in the Department of ECE at SSN College of Engineering, Chennai. He received his BE in ECE from C. Abdul Hakim College in 2008, followed by ME, Master in Communication from C. Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering in 2010. He worked as a programmer analyst in CTS for 1.5 hours, and he has more than 9 years of teaching experience. His research interests include information theory and coding, image processing, machine learning, deep learning, and wireless sensor network. Currently, he is working on a research ambition, ambient assistant living for elderly people. So I think Mr. Hashim, the speaker of this session, have joined us. Mr. Hashim, B.A.
Yes. Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah. I can hear you. Now I request the speaker to take over this session and deliver your research address to the participants.
Thank you. Can you give me the privilege to share this screen?
Yes, Mr. Hashim, now you have the privilege. You can share
the other one.
The other one. I can see the login name, Muhammad Hashim.
Yeah, other one is there.
Okay. Yes, may I know what is... Yeah.
Muhammad, this is also Muhammad Hashim. The two logins. Oh, it's a host disabled participant screen share. Yes. Yeah, you have given, I think.
Yeah, I have given the privilege to both.
Thank you. Can you see the presentation now? Yes.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. C.F. Abdul Rahman for giving the introduction. Before we start this session, I'd like to thank our management and our department head, Dr. C. Mohammad Yusuf, for giving me the opportunity to present in this 5-day Atal online FDP program on biomims and lab on chip technologies for point of care application. Hi, this is B.A. Mohammad Hashim, Assistant Professor, Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering and Technology. The topic what we're going to discuss today is artificial intelligence and disruptive technologies in point of care. So people have been discussing about artificial intelligence for past decade, and disruptive technology is nothing but new innovations. Okay, before we get into the topic, just want to read out the outline what we're going to see today. So we're going to see about artificial intelligence and machine learning and few machine learning techniques, basic techniques, and how artificial intelligence can be used in healthcare technology, and evolution of microfluidics, and mapping of microfluidic applications in different architectures of deep learning, and the role of artificial intelligence in healthcare technology, and a recent thing that is the pandemic COVID-19, and how AI has been used to fight COVID-19, and point of care testing, and a few of the applications we're going to discuss in our presentation. Okay. So the question arises, whenever we go to automation, artificial intelligence, will robot take our job? And people have the misconception that the artificial intelligence is equal to automation. So that is not the case. Every automation does not belong to artificial intelligence, and most of the people misunderstood it, even don't know the full potential capabilities of artificial intelligence. But slowly people are starting, and they are understanding how AI can be used in their particular field, particularly in healthcare system. Okay. Now, artificial intelligence. So we have several elements. We have several elements in artificial intelligence. Before we go into what is artificial intelligence, we have several elements, like you have fuzzy logic, and you have neural networks, you have neurofuzzy, and we have genetic algorithm. All those four items are inside artificial intelligence. Take for example, fuzzy logic is nothing but, simply saying, it is nothing but logical decision making. So we have, in real time example, we can say we are using our washing machines, where you can see fuzzy logic enabled a fully automatic washing machine. So it's a logical decision making. When you go out, your family member says, it may rain today, take the umbrella. They are not calculating any humidity value. They are not calculating any temperature value. Still, they say, they predict it may rain today based on what they already learned. So this is logical decision making. So artificial intelligence has specific applications. Yeah, some specific applications are like natural language processing. It can be speech recognition, and it can be machine vision. Okay. So machine learning is part of, it's a part of artificial intelligence. It is a part of artificial intelligence. And machine learning, where we are going to make the neural network learn. So neural network actually possesses two basic properties of natural human brain, that is learning and associative property and ignoring property. Okay, neural networks, we are using artificial intelligence itself. It is nothing but biologically inspired. Like human has natural intelligence, machines, when they possess the intelligence, we say it as artificial intelligence. So machine learning, when we go for learning, there are three types we have. One is supervised learning. You have unsupervised learning. You have semi-supervised learning. So supervised learning, when we train the neural network, we even give the labels for classification. We give the labels and then we train it. And when we, in the case of unsupervised learning, we will not give any labels. The network itself will group. And whenever we give the test data, it will find out the distance and it will label that test data as a particular group. And semi-supervised combination of. Machine learning and deep learning is when machine learning, you will extract the features from the data and we will train the, you will train the neural network. Whereas in deep learning, we will give the data assets and the features will be extracted by the network and automatically it will be trained and we can give the test data and it will give you the test results. Okay, deep transfer learning. So what we have in transfer learning, we are, it's like knowledge transition. So somebody learns something and teaches the information to some other person who doesn't know. So what happens in transfer learning, we have many pre-trained models like AlexNet, we have GoogleNet, we have DocNet, RichNet, and so many different pre-trained networks are available where thousands of images have been already trained and we have extracted weights. So we give data for training and testing. It will actually take weights to calculate.
Yes,
calculate and it will find the network and we will give the, it will give the test. Okay. So participants, if you can mute. Mute.
You can carry on, sir.
Yes, I request the participants if you have a mute. Yeah, thank you. So we're already using ML and artificial intelligence. You have K nearest neighbor. Just a second.
Speaker, sir, I think you have muted your audio. It's not audible to the participants.
Is it audible now?
No, sir. No, sir.
Is it audible? Now.
Yeah, now. Now you can proceed on. You can carry on, sir. Speaker, sir, again, we are not getting your voice. I think it's again muted.
Now? Okay. Is it audible now?
Yeah, now.
Okay. So we'll be discussing some simple machine learning approaches. Nearest neighbor and random forest and support vector machine. So K nearest neighbor, where we'll be having those red and the black groups, you have two classification. And when we give the yellow star, that is the test data, it will automatically based on the distance. Just a second. Was it audible with in the previous slide?
So there is a small problem with your audio, not getting your audio clearly. This is a request from the participants.
Yes, can you hear me now? Okay. Shall I start from the previous slide or shall I go with this slide?
Yes, sir, you can carry on now. Now I hope your voice is...
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we'll be discussing some machine learning approaches like KNN, K-nearest neighbor, random forest and support vector machine. So in K-nearest neighbor, you have two groups, black and red groups. You can see when you give biggest data, based on the distance, it will label the test data as either black or red group. So in the case of random forest, majority voting trees will be, number of decision trees will be created and majority voting will happen, and you will find out the resultant test case. And in the case of support vector machine, it constructs a hyperplane that actually just separates the groups, and it will give you the test results. In the case of multiple classes, we can go for multi SVM also, and other techniques are also available. Machine learning techniques like naive Bayes and some other techniques are also available. But now we move on to the next slide. Not going to the next slide. Yes. Okay. So, what are the opportunities we have for AI and ML in healthcare today? So, we have so much of data, laboratory utilization data, and we have staffing numbers and load balancing error detection. We have so many examples where we can explore this AI and ML in healthcare today. So we can create the well-defined data sets for further research, and for data analytics we can use it. Workflow optimization also we can use it. Image and pattern recognition, like face recognition of patients, and the pre-analytic error detection, and the well-defined disease conditions, either it is earlier problem or it is in critical condition, all those things we can identify. Take for example acute kidney injury and myocardial infarction, and obviously point of care testing where lab interpretation is not possible or available, we can go. And we'll see a brief history of deep learning and microfluidics. So evolution of microfluidics started from late 50s, and from the first integrated circuit, and then first microprocessor, then lab on chip in the late 70s, and in the late 90s, prototyping started with PDMS, and then microfluidics started from there. So deep learning, earlier 50s, you have perceptron, then backpropagation, first RNN in 80s, and then machine learning from 90s to 2010, and then we have deep learning, and now you have transfer learning and all those cases. So this is the basic history of deep learning and microfluidics. Let us take five applications in microfluidics and try to map those applications to deep learning architectures. So cell classification can be done using microfluidics, and we can do signal processing, we can do DNA base calling, we can do flow sculpting, we can have cell segmentation been done.
So we have used five different deep learning architectures for each in application. In the case of SIL classification, unstructured to unstructured deep learning architecture has been used, where the input is SIL writes and we can identify SIL classes. In the case of sequence of voltages from signal processing application, we can use sequence to unstructured architecture, where we can identify the output will be pressure. And a sequence of events from DNA-based calling, sequence to sequence structure is used, DNA sequence can be identified. And flow sculpting, you can give flow images, microfluidic flow images to image to unstructured architecture, and the output can be microfiller geometry. Image to image, very simple one, you can give images of different cells and we can identify those cells. So further, we will see it in deep. So the input to the unstructured to unstructured deep learning architecture for SIL classification, it can be circularity, perimeter and measure axis, whereas the output will be white blood cell or colon cell. It will find out the type of cell. In the case of sequence to unstructured deep learning architecture, the signal processing, where analog voltage with respect to time can be given as the input and we can identify pressure. In the case of sequence to sequence deep learning architecture, we can give these signals. We can give the signals and we can identify the DNA sequence. In case of image to unstructured architecture, we can give the flow shape as the input image, and we can identify those pillars and red blood cell or lymphocyte. We can identify it. And the image to image architecture, we can give cell images and we can identify segmented image. We can get those counts and all those things we can identify using this deep learning architecture, image to image deep learning architecture. Now, artificial intelligence in medicine, maybe in physical branch, we will discuss. You can have so many sensors. You can have some smart watches where you have heart rate sensor, you have sleeping patterns, so you can identify your sleeping pattern. You can identify how many steps you have walked through the day. And you can use accelerometers to identify the activities a particular person has done. And all those information you can use and you can send it to the cloud, and the medical caretaker or any service provider can help in identifying the situation of a particular patient for continuous monitoring. So a timeline of AI in health. In 1955, this term was coined by John McCarthy and founded as an academic discipline in 1956 in US. And from 60s to 70s, the first problem solving program has been produced called Dendral Assisting to identify bacteria and recommending antibiotics. From 80s to in the next 10 years, in 80s to 90s, growth of microcomputer and network connectivity has grown a big way, and AI systems in healthcare was designed to accommodate the absence of perfect data and build on the expertise of physicians. From 2010 to 2019, genomic sequence databases, AI in electronic record systems, natural language processing and computer vision, robot-assisted surgeries, and etc. From 2019 onwards, discovery and development of drugs, preclinical research, personalized healthcare systems, and many more applications are continuously evolving in the field of healthcare for AI. So these are the areas we can explore the AI in healthcare. So this patient facing, you have broad category, you have telehealth, you have doctor facing and research. And patient-facing, we can go for AI chatbots, wearable devices, personalized genetics, so we can go for mental health, women's health, and skin types. And in the case of research, drug discovery, information and clinical trials, genetic research, telehealth, telemedicine, lifestyle management, and disease management. And doctor-facing, medical records, data analytics, medical imaging, and hospitals. These are the areas AI has been explored in healthcare. So now we move on to the topic of role of artificial intelligence in health, keeping well. So healthy lifestyle is very important. So we can use AI to make a person healthier. So you have so many smartwatches now, like Fitbit and some other smartwatches. It can track down your sleeping patterns. You can know your sleeping pattern. You can know your heart rate. and some smartwatches have even blood pressure details, and how many steps you have walked through the day, so that you can, how much calories you have burned, and all those details can be learned from these kind of smartwatches, where AI plays a big role in keeping the health well and in a healthier lifestyle. And case of early detection, early detection is very important. So according to American Cancer Society, high proportion of mammograms yield the fast results, leading to 1 in 2 healthy women being told they have cancer. But enabling with AI is actually 30 times faster with 99% accuracy, thus actually reducing the need for unnecessary biopsies. And a recent thing like Google's DeepMind Health is working in partnership with several clinicians around the world, and even in India, researchers and patients to solve and detect real-world healthcare problems. Artificial intelligence for diabetic retinopathy screening in Africa. So in this literature, you can see they have used artificial intelligence to identify a diabetic retinopathy screening in Africa. One of the major advantages of using AI is it can be used to train the non-clinicians. It can be used to train the non-clinicians, fresh clinicians, people who don't have expertise. It will give them idea how the images can be. Within minutes, it will give the results, and instant feedback can be given to the patients. In Tamil Nadu and Madurai, a hospital called Aravind Hive Hospital recently signed a MOU with Google DeepMind Health, where they are, it's an eye hospital. So they are using non-diabetic patients images, eye retinopathy images, retina images, and diabetic retina patient retina images. Millions of images have been used, and they are trying. What they claim is there will be a time when people can take selfies of their eyes on the phone camera, and they will get instant access to their ophthalmic care. So that is possible. That is possible. If now what is the case, we need to go to a clinic or hospital, eye hospital. You need to go and wait. You need to get the appointment of the doctor. Then they will use some. Apparatus to identify what is the problem with your retina. So now I request the organizer to play the video, first video.
Yes, sure, sir.
So video number one, I think I have shared the link to. This hospital is in New York City, so Mount Sinai Hospital. So they are fighting COVID-19 with the power of AI. So they initially, when they started, there was a huge crisis in the US. You already know that. What they did is they collected so much of data, COVID data. They identified the problem with COVID is early detection will lead to early treatment and early recovery. So they want data. So they collected data. They hired people in a background of data science and AI. And what they did is, based on the samples they have already got and the data they have received, they can identify early stages of the disease, this contagious disease, so that they can They can monitor the patient. They can give the treatment early, and even they can identify when the patient can be discharged. And all those things have been possible with the use of AI in fighting this COVID-19. So the entire thing is that one. So yeah, you can close the video. Yeah, you can close the video.
Okay, sir.
Yes. So now, role of artificial intelligence health in diagnosis. So one of the big player in AI, IBM Watson, for health, they are helping the healthcare organizations to review and store far more medical information. So journals and symptoms and all those data they are using. And within a blink of an eye, unimaginable amount of data can be processed using AI. Even smallest of detail can be spotted using medical imaging. That is possible in the case of breast cancer and aortic aneurysms and many other diseases. We can use nearly 90% accuracy rate. That is possible with the use of artificial intelligence in diagnosis. So this is another literature where the authors claim this artificial intelligence is gradually leading to three main directions. One is making patients the point of care. Patients need not to go to the laboratories. They can buy some point of care devices. They can test themselves, not for all the diseases, for something. And they have created a vast amount of data that requires advanced analytics for doing research. They can use it. And the third direction is they made the foundation of precision medicine, for which disease, which medicine can be given to the patient. So here another article where the research actually shows AI may help diagnose tuberculosis in remote areas. So this is a semantic MD AI box that can analyze chest X-ray within 20 seconds, and it will run with a portable phone charger. So countries where you have huge population in Southeast Asia, China, and Africa, where it can be used to identify the early stages of tuberculosis. And even the cost will be less than $1 per scan. The X-ray will be there. The X-ray analyzing can be done using this device. So next one is syndrome definition validation approach for Zika virus. Why I have chosen Zika virus? Region news. Three people have been affected by Zika virus in Kerala. Region news. And Zika virus, like the COVID, it's a contagious device. So you have influenza, plague, and anthrax. All those contagious devices. We need to identify in the case of contagious devices, we need to identify the symptoms. Yearly treatment is very important. So we can use AI because we'll get so many data from the medical institutions. We can train them. We can identify when we give this sample automatically, it will identify whether it is in the early stage or it is in the critical stage. That is possible. So public health concerns. One of the important concern with respect to this infectious diseases is cost. So much billion of money have been used in medical expenses throughout the world. And when we use AI automatically, cost cutting can happen. That will be a huge thing, a public concern. And in this literature, artificial intelligence application for COVID-19 pandemic, these authors have collected so much of data. They have found what they claim is they have identified 7 significant applications of AI for COVID-19 pandemic. And their artificial intelligence application can detect a cluster of cases that will happen. And they can even predict where this virus will affect in future. So all this is possible because of AI. So that's one important thing. In these testing times, clinicians, academicians, and the government entities have combined together. They are working and fighting against this COVID-19 using artificial intelligence, machine learning, and data science. A team of scientists at the University of Liverpool, UK, they have used AI to work out where the next novel coronavirus could emerge. This is actually reported in BBC. So the researchers use a combination of biology and machine learning in this case, and their algorithm can predict many more potential hosts of new virus strains, like initial COVID-19, then second wave, Delta. Now people are saying third wave, Delta plus, and all those strains, new strains, can also be detected, predicted using AI. That is possible. Request the organizer to play the second video. So here, how people are using AI. So they have used a Lunit. Lunit is a device which can be used to analyze chest X-ray. So one of the things in contagious devices, we need to identify initially, we need to distance them, and we need to treat them on time, and we need to identify how the drug or treatment is going on, how it's effective on the disease, and all those things can be identified using this Lunit system. And one more thing, the results you can see in the video. In the video, you can see the results, how much time it takes for a conventional testing method to give the result, and using this one, how much time it takes using artificial intelligence. So sensitivity here, you can see 96% sensitivity. Normal method, Lunit, you have 96% sensitivity. That's a huge margin, like 5% margin. Normal thoracic radiologist, 5% in sensitivity is high. It's a good one. So AI-aided chest radiography takes 51 minutes to give the result, whereas RT-PCR more than 8 hours it takes to give the result. So here we can see that one. Okay. You can stop the video. Yes. Initially, people were not using or giving importance to AI in healthcare. Now people are using, clinical uses increase. Even they use AI to flag warning signs of space sepsis. And even they can use examine therapeutic options for patients with disease. Not only clinical use, even pharmaceuticals, pharmacy, they're using AI to process huge volume of data and make R&D more efficient. So areas of real promise, imaging. One of the interesting things, since 2014, the startups with imaging and diagnostics in healthcare was 25%. So out of 125 startups are in imaging and diagnostics. So a recent example, I already told, Google DeepMind researchers developed a system for diagnosing eye disease and quickly triaging patients. Benefit is, the ability to quickly identify emergent events and speed up the delivery of treatment in time-critical circumstances. So hospitals where people are using AI, Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center uses Amazon AI to schedule its operating rooms. Many hospitals are using AI to detect onset of sepsis. It's a big killer device, killer disease in US. And another key explanation is risk of mortality and readmission. So as I already told, healthcare AI sees 300 plus first equity rounds since 2016. So many people are coming with AI startups, AI health startups since 2014. It is keep on increasing, and nearly 25% of these startups are in AI health startup. So what is the benefit of artificial intelligence? AI can definitely assist physicians, but it cannot replace physicians. So it cannot replace the doctors. So it can assist, in what way it can assist for clinical decision making, better clinical decisions. In somewhere like radiology, some places it can replace human judgment, and we can use to get up-to-date details from journals, textbooks, and clinical practices. And one more thing, fresh clinicians and experienced clinicians, we can differentiate, and fresh clinicians can learn from AI results, and the early diagnosis is possible using artificial intelligence. And we can even predict the outcome of any disease as well as the treatment. And it will increase the patient safety and huge cost saving associated with the use of AI. Cost saving is very important. You go and test blood glucose, you go and test blood glucose in the laboratory. You need to go to the laboratory, you need to wait, you get the appointment, you give the sample, they will ask you to come afterwards, you will come back to your home and go back again. It will take some time. Whereas now what happens, you have a handheld device where you use a strip, you put a drop of blood, and you can identify the glucose level in your blood. So cost cutting is one of the main things we're using AI. And when we go to point of care testing, the definition is medical testing at or near the site of patient care. Next to patients will be having the system to monitor them. And the goal is to increase decrease the therapeutic turnaround time. So there are some formats like disposable. So we can take the example of pregnancy test kits. It's disposable. We can use a handheld device like AccuCheck, where you will use chip and you will insert in the handheld device. It will give you data. One, you will replace the chip in the next time. So portable devices are available. PCOT, transportable benchtop monitoring, and even smart devices which can transmit the data to the cloud, and the caretakers and healthcare providers can monitor the patient remotely. So that is also possible using POCT. In this literature, the authors have used machine learning based on multi-analyte delta checks to detect wrong blood in tuberous. What is the wrong blood in tuberous? Sometimes these blood specimens collected from one patient occasionally gets mislabeled with identifiers from a different patient. So this is called the wrong blood in tube error, and it will potentially harm the patients. So they have developed this algorithm which can detect WAD errors, and it can mitigate patient harm. In this literature, point of care testing for AKI is nothing but acute kidney injury. Biomarkers in severe burn patients. Okay. So 58% of the time, the burn patients experience AKI. That too, initially in the first period, post admission, 58% burn patients experience acute kidney injury. Okay. So why it is happening? So automatically, all the liquid from the body will be dried up. So it will definitely injure the kidney. So we can take data from both AKI, non-AKI patients, acute kidney injury patients, and non-acute kidney injury patients. These are the data we can collect, and we can huge data you can collect, and you can find the neural network, you can get the results. So you have the right hand side, you have traditional workflow, and you have in the left hand side, you have ML guided workflow. Post the patient admission, sample will be taken and put it in the POCT. So you have AI which can calculate the distance. If the data is nearer to AKI, it will label it as AKI acute injury is there, and if it is nearer to no AKI, automatically it will identify and label it as no AKI patient. Whereas the same thing in conventional traditional workflow, it will calculate, but at time TN it will calculate. Whereas in ML guided workflow, we can identify, we can get the result within a few hours, and that at T1 we can get it earlier. So in this literature, so the authors are saying this AI associated healthcare market can reach $6.6 billion this year, according to Accenture. And one more thing, this application, AI application, will create opportunities about $150 billion by saving healthcare costs by 2026. It can save by 2026, it can save healthcare costs up to $150 billion. And what is the advantage? POCT cheaper, faster, and easier to check for quality control. And in this literature, the authors have used AI on skin diseases. So you have lesions as benign or malignant. They have used so many images. They have trained, they have tested by giving the images of lesion skin. They have identified whether this is a benign lesion or malignant lesion. So it can play a huge role in image processing for skin diseases also. What are the advantages we have for point of care? Reduced turnaround time, so less time to give the result, and a reduction in hospital admission. So most of the time we go to hospital for continuous checking, and that can be reduced, and improved interaction between patient and carer, and reduction in clinical visits. And just now I told it can reduce the cost, so that can be there. And with respect to the administrative work associated with test requesting and reporting, so so many test results they have to give, so it may take so much time. So you can use POCT and we can get the results as soon as possible. And the point of care types, classification types, you have single use, you have multiple use. So single use, you have qualitative characteristic. So you can use a blood strip, and even like pregnancy test kit can be single use, and a quantitative cartridge with a reader device like IQ check, where you insert the strip with the sample, you can read the data in the handheld device. Multiple use benchtop devices are also available. How to assure quality? Quality. So we discussed with POCT. We are saying so many advantages of POCT. We are saying so many advantages of AI in healthcare, but at the end, these are all assistive technology for physicians. But at the same time, we need to increase the accuracy. We need to assure the quality. So what are the things we require? How to assure the quality of any POCT device? So selection of validated method with traceability, method with reasonable accuracy, precision and measurement uncertainty, our selection of a method with the ability to monitor performance, and setting up a POCT management team, training of personnel, how to use it, and establishing documentation system, preparation of SOPs and manuals. This is how you can assure quality with POCT devices. Accreditation, yeah, it is available. Similar to 15189 ISO, you have ISO 22870, which actually gives accreditation for POCT testing, but they have two requirements, management requirements and technical requirements. In management requirements, you have QMS, quality objectives, preventive, corrective, and review. So technical requirements, you need personnel, training, accommodation environment, equipment, pre-examination, examination and post-examination, all those details with respect to technical requirements are required. And this literature, AI application in stroke. Stroke is actually affecting more than 500 million people worldwide. And it is a leading cause of death in China and one of the fifth disease, killer disease in North America. So people are spending nearly $689 billion as medical expense across the world for treating this stroke. For stroke, you need to identify yearly. Once you identify yearly, you can give one the treatment. Only few patients could receive timely treatment. So yearly detection is very important. So people use human activity recognition and some stroke onset detection stage. Once any abnormal movement of the patient is identified against the normal pattern, alert of stroke would be activated and evaluated for treatment as soon as possible. This is they have used SVM, Marco models, hidden Marco models, and SVM, and nearly 90.5% of the time they have rightly classified they had these stroke symptoms. So stroke symptom is very important. So most of the people neglect stroke symptoms. At the end, in severe stage, they will be affected. So it can be deadly, but deadly. So it has to be identified early, in the early stage. So AI can be used in stroke. So I told you, like human activity recognition can be used to identify stroke, unusual behavior, abnormal behavior, elderly patient monitoring, we can use like child monitoring and healthcare, all here we can use activity recognition. So elderly patient monitoring also, we can use activity recognition techniques. So in this literature, the authors have used a smartphone and their sensors. So accelerometer and gyroscope sensors to identify and to identify the activities of the particular person. And they have produced a data set of elderly people aging more than 60 from 10 people, five women and five men. And they have classified six activities, daily activities like walking, sitting, standing, and walking upstairs, downstairs. And all those activities they have classified. And they have achieved nearly 98% of result in classifying those activities. So these activities, these kind of ideas can be used for assisting assisting healthcare and for the disabled, and it can be for the elderly people monitoring or even patient monitoring. We can use it to get the health parameters and we can do that. So take the case of ambient assisted living. So you have a elderly home. You have an elderly home where you have independent elders, and you will be using health sensors, health parameter capturing sensors. You'll be using some activity sensors. All those data will be sent to the cloud, and the caretakers or family and friends will be continuously monitoring their health parameters and their activities. Whenever they find any unusual thing in their health parameter or any abnormal behavior using activity recognition, they will be given some alarm and they can arrive at this spot and they can identify and they treat them. And even to the caretakers and to the healthcare providers, even to the hospitals, they can send the alarm and they can come early and they can treat them. So why AL? What is AL? People with disabilities are for adults who cannot live independently. So with an increasing interest in human health, it is very necessary to know the lifestyle of the patient. If you want to treat treat any patient, you need to have the record, their medical record, their information. All these informations can be monitored using ambient assisted living. So what are the activities they usually do? In the case of elderly people, what are the activities they usually do? If you have the set of usual activities and the abnormal activities, you can easily identify which one is abnormal activity and which one is usual activity. We can identify all those things using ambient assisted living. And what is the future scenario? So collaboration between medical and technical institutions, collaboration with between medical and technical institutions. But it is happening in Western countries, whereas in India, most of the medical institutions are hesitate in giving the data to the researchers. And people are expecting the government to make the data sets for research, open source data sets. And laboratories and clinics need to collaborate to accelerate the implementation of electronic health records. So they need to give the health records to the researchers, so that since people are knowing the importance of AI in healthcare, so data from the laboratories and clinics, this has to be shared to the researchers. Only when they have the data, they can work on the data and they will get some results. the data has to be captured in real time, and the institutions must promote the transformation into intelligible process and simplification, readability, clinical utility of data sets, aim of increasing their clinical value and decreasing health cost. Health cost has to be reduced. And one of the main thing in using AI is early detection, targeted prevention. You can early detection, early treatment, early recovery. That is possible. In this testing times like COVID-19, early detection is important. We need to identify with the symptoms. We need to isolate them, and then we need to treat them. We can use AI, and we can use the data already available. We can even find out how the body is reacting to the medicine they are giving, and when the patient can be discharged. All those informations can be retrieved from AI. So that is possible. And already I have shown you a video like the Mount Sinai that hospital is using AI to carry out this information they are fighting AI with. They are fighting COVID with AI. So thank you. I hope for yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker, Mr. B.A. Hashim, for your presentation. It's time for the participants to place your queries. So after this session, you have the validity and as well as the feedback session. So I request the participant to be stay with us and also join with us in the validity functions. Any queries from the participant?
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Can you please hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello, yes, sir.
Yeah. You can ask the question, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, can we integrate AI ML for this point of care devices?
Yeah, we can integrate, sir. I think I have shown some examples where they used AI in these point of care devices. And they're getting the results. That is possible, sir. That is possible. We can use it. So in one of the architecture, also deep learning architecture, I have shown you, like flow image from microfluidic flow image can be given as the input to image to structured deep learning architecture. We can get the results. That is possible, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you.
Any other participants to place your queries?
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Yes, this is Sindhu, sir.
Yes.
So I need one clarification. Is that Alzheimer's disease classification can incorporate with artificial intelligence?
Alzheimer's disease, which type of images you're going to use, ma'am? MRI scan images?
Yes, sir.
Scan images, you're going to use scan images using image processing, or how you're going to do?
MRI image based.
That is possible. You can collect the images, and you have some open source images, and you can even get those images from medical institutions, and you can train, and you can get the results. That is possible.
Okay, so thank you.
Good evening, Professor Hashim.
Good evening.
My question is, how this human activity recognition could be useful in point of care application?
Can you come up again? What's the question?
Is it audible?
Yeah, now.
My question is, how human activity recognition is useful in point of care application?
Yeah, point of care application, I told you in the last literature, stroke disease can be identified with early symptoms. So if stroke disease, the early symptoms will be like abnormal behavior of patients, abnormal behavior of people. So when you use human activity recognition, abnormal behavior can be identified. With that, we can identify the symptoms of stroke initially, early stages of stroke, and we can treat them.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you Mr. Hashim for your presentation in this 14th session of this AICTE sponsored FDP. So now successfully we are on the track and we have completed our 14th session of this FDP. I thank all the participants to be with us and also I request the participant to be in the last session of this FDP. So our last session we'll start by 3:15 because our principal, who is a chief guest in this valedictory function, is in a meeting. He will be joining us by 3:10. So I think if you be joined with us, so we will start our valedictory function by 3:15 p.m. And also the session 14 feedback will also be shared in the valedictory function. And also you have an oral feedback session followed by a quiz. The quiz link also will be posted in the same Zoom chat. So I request the participant to be stay with us till 3:15 p.m. until we start the valedictory function. I welcome all the participants to be a part in this validity function. So before validity function, it's time for an oral feedback session. So for the past 5 days continuously, we are on a track to organize this FDP on BioMEMS Lab on Chip for point of care applications. We got different speakers from India and abroad, from Malaysia as well as Switzerland. I think the sessions were very quite interesting and it will be very beneficial for the participants in research aspect. There may be something negative, there may be something plus or minus from our organizer's side. So that is why it's a general oral feedback session. So I request the participants to give some feedback regarding this event, how we organize for this 5-day FDP. I request the participant to be frank and come forward, because this feedback what you give will be definitely provide a strength for us to organize this event, such events, in a very good effective manner in the upcoming days. So really, I think this is a very tedious job for us. Whenever we got approval from the AACT, we have been planning. We have been planning how to organize this FDP, because we have two proposals, one is offline as well as online. Initially, we preferred the online mode of organizing this event. We thought this will be a very easy mode for us, but actually while organizing the speakers and allotting the schedule time for them, we thought we got a lot of difficulties we are facing. So I think we have reached the last part. So I request the participant to come forward. If you have any queries as well as any feedback from your side, you can deliver with us so that we can strengthen with your feedback. So I request the participant. So many participants, I can see some active participants. Arthur Clive, Parna Annapurna, Ashish sir. I request the participants, Dr. Yuvraj sir, Dr. N.S. Gowri. I request the participants to give your oral feedback with us for organizing this FDP.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. This is Dr. Ishwaran. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible, sir. You're audible.
So really, I thank the organizers. It's a really wonderful workshops they organized. So I thought that this might be just like something like other programs which is done by Atal. It is completely different, and the unique thing is you are covered under research perspective. So almost every speakers, they have acknowledgedly shared their research works, and they have even given a lot of avenues for those who are attendees to open up their research. So that is one more thing. Almost all the speakers are really good. So they have made excellent speakers for all the sessions. So that is also the highlights of this. You have started all the programs in time. So that is also one of the critical tasks. So you have managed that. So only thing is, yeah, on and off, the audio might be a drop. The rest of the things are very nice. But video quality and other things
are good. We thought we can unmute the audio of the participant, but few speakers are from abroad. Yes. In between, the speakers are interacting. They want to interact with the participants. So that is why we have given the privilege for the participants to mute and unmute that. And I think Okay, thank you, sir. Overall,
the content is really good, sir. The content, how they presented and what they shared, which is covered the theme of your workshop, and it's really good. So I appreciate all the speakers. It's not an easy job. It's a very good. You have taken a lot of efforts in organizing such a good event. So this may help many people to open up their research in this particular domain. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I request a few more participants to give your valuable feedback. Because in the AICT schedule, a separate time session has been allotted for having this oral feedback session from the participants. While uploading, we have to upload the content of the videos as well as the clips of the oral feedback session we got. And after the completion of this session, our college will provide a feedback. And finally, I think, sir, from the AICT, you will be having a common feedback. And you have to fill up that feedback about this 5-day FDP program. Then only you can be eligible for getting the certificate.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Is it audible, sir?
Yeah, audible, sir. I think MD Sajid is
available. Yes, sir. This is Mohammed Sajid.
Yeah, Mohammed.
First of all, I congratulate the event coordinator, Dr. C. Mohammed Yusuf sir, and C. Abdul Rahman sir, for arranging such wonderful faculty development program. We learned many information, sir, about the BioMEMS. So you arranged such very good experts, Malaysian, Indian, everything. So I hope this information very useful, sir, to all the research scholar. So I am also a research scholar. It is very useful for me. And also, it is very, I hope it is very useful in all the faculty members. Once again, I thank all the experts and coordinators. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And one difficulty what we had while we are approaching our foreign abroad speakers, the time concern is a very important thing. When we approached Malaysian speaker, if you go for the evening session, it comes 2.5 hours again. It's delay for them. That was a very difficult task for us while arranging. But anyhow, we tried our best, and we request further participants to have an oral feedback about this FDP. I am very much happy that there are nearly more than 45 active participants. Daily they are participating on time. I have been seeing some of the names. I got memorized the name of the participants who are joining us at the earlier time. I request the participants to have an oral general oral feedback. You can share your ideas, or if you have any difficulty you have faced while attending this FDP, you can also share.
Good afternoon, sir. Can you listen to me?
Yeah, sir.
This is Mohammed Mian, and thanks for organizing such a wonderful FDP for the past 5 days. And I thoroughly enjoyed all the sessions, and many of the sessions were very useful. As straightly point in the very first day, it is not a single discipline oriented, a multidiscipline oriented, and plenty of researchers are going on in this. And I thank the coordinators, sir, and the hosts and co-hosts, sir, and all the team for organizing the such an excellent FDP. And as you were telling, it's not easy for us to pick up the speakers, to get acknowledgement from the speakers, and from different countries, the time will be different. The very first session, a speaker from Switzerland, as you were telling, it's early morning, the 5 o'clock or 5:15. He has to get up and then he has to get ready. That is not going to be easy. So with different time zones are there. So you take care of the time zones, and we should also thank the speakers because they came in time, and most of them, they took the time, their valued time, and they answered the queries also. And once again, I congratulate and thanks all the organizers and C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering Technology Management team for providing this wonderful FDP. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think it's not good to call the participant names for the FDP, but in a friendly way, I'll call some of our participants, Dr. Belsam Jebanan, who used to join us very earlier in each and every session. I request Dr. Belsam Jebanan, sir, to give some valuable feedback for this 5-day FDP session. We have Dr. Anjana, yeah. Dr. M. Nalini.
Yeah, sir, good afternoon.
Dr. Yuvaraj, sir.
Yeah, sir, good afternoon. Yeah, this is Dr. Belsam from SRM University. And I would like to thank all the eminent dignitaries from C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering from Vellore. And every session was really went on well, and it was a meaningful session and one of the latest applications. As of now, it's required for not only the teachers and for the student community. So whoever joined as a teachers here, definitely they will convert the same thing towards for students community, thereby more number of research activities will progress on the forthcoming days. And especially thanks to the HOD of EC department and all the faculty members, and especially Sindhu ma'am, for all the timely announcements in the prayer earlier announcements, and also in the earlier day, they will send the reminder email as well as every updates in the WhatsApp. Normally every adult programs I used to attend, but here the announcements are very clear and all in advance. So I would like to thank the entire team of Abdul Hakim College of Engineering, Vellore, and also the entire management. And thanks to EC department for a wonderful opportunity for the last 5 days, and very good speakers from the abroad. Many abroad speakers have given all the lively talk along with the practical aspects. Normally the other FTPs in other colleges, they will take all the Indian speakers, but here most of the speakers from abroad, and we have got lot of research perspectives to nurture ourselves to focus on the forthcoming days in the field of chip technology. So thanks to everyone, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And from SSN, I think Ghulam Alsar sir also have joined us in this FDP program. I'm feel happy, I think. I request Ghulam Alsar sir also to give you any valuable feedback for this FDP.
Hi sir, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam sir.
Thank you for calling me out, sir. It is indeed, no, it's a great honor to be with this FDP. No, actually I did not expect that you will make it such a massive program. I really enjoyed all the sessions. And to be very frank, no, few of the experts shared their laboratory videos, which I found it very interesting. And no, I actually made some screen recording of their labs as well. So I, to be very frank, I did not expect such kind of an organization or such kind of speakers in your program. And I wish you guys make much more higher level FDPs in the years to come. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your feedback.
Yeah.
Dr. Yuvaraj, sir, you're also a very earlier participant to join. Whenever we start our session, you will be waiting in the lobby. I can't point out all the participants. Just to make this session to be interactive, I'll be calling the name of the participant. Usually in a gathering, it's not good to call the name of the participant.
Good afternoon.
A very good afternoon, sir.
Sir, first of all, I am very thankful to the management, principal, EEC staff, and the coordinators of this wonderful FDP arranged by C. Hakim College of Engineering Technology. The selection of the topic was wonderful, need of the hour. And the one important thing which I have noticed is the time management and the coordination was very, very, very motivating to the speaker, to the participants. And I think you might have done a lot of groundwork to make this materialize. And the program was meticulously planned and executed. I really thank the entire team which has made this beautiful exercise dream come true. So I thank all for giving an opportunity for me also to be a part of this. And the arranging the guest speakers and from various countries and putting it together in a very concise capsule manner, really hats off. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me an
opportunity. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable feedback. Now it's time, I think we'll start our validatory function. Our principal, Dr. Bhaskaran sir, have joined us. The Department of ECEC Abdul Hakim College of Engineering and Technology, Tamil Nadu, was hosting this AICT ATEL Training and Learning Academy sponsored online FTP on BioMEMS and Lab-on-Chip Technologies for point of care application for the past 5 days from 5th to 9th July. The goal of the program was to enhance the researchers to involve in research and teaching methodologies. All the faculties attended the session. They showed a great enthusiasm throughout this 5 days. So in C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering and Technology, the inaugural session was hosted in the present college chairman, Dr. Yaudin Ahmed, and correspondent Dr. V. M. Abdul Latif. Our principal, Dr. J. Bhaskaran of this institution, proposed the inaugural address to the participant. Dr. C. Muhammad Yusuf, the HOD, as well as the coordinator of this event, highlighted the objective and outcome of this FDP. Mr. A. Muhammad Mian have welcomed the gathering, and myself, with your support, hosted this event. So around 110 participants from various parts of the states of this India have confirmed their participation in this 5-day event in prayer to be conducted using this Zoom video conferencing tool. The online FDP session is handled by experts from Switzerland, Malaysia, and from various reputed institutions and research lab functioning in different state of the India as well as out of that is from other countries. The faculty development program organized at C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering and Technology, Melvi Sharam campus, was based on the theme BioMEMS and Lab on Chip Technologies for Point of Care Applications. So during this 5-day program, the sessions were handled on the following topics. Session 1 by Microfluidics for Point of Care Applications by Dr. S. K. Ramiz Iqbal from Switzerland. Session 2, Security and Sensing Devices for Healthcare Technologies by Dr. Surajit Debarat. Third session, Point of Care Test Device for Health Monitoring by Dr. Khairun Nisa Amrin from BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus. Fourth session, Lab on Chip Technologies for Water Quality Monitoring by Dr. Ashish Kapoor, SRM University. Devices and Energy Harvesting Solutions for Wearable Technologies by Dr. H. Umma Habiba. From BHIER, Chennai, a non-invasive measurement technique based on microfluidic platform for single analysis in the session 6 by Dr. Muhammad Rizwan bin Ahmad from Malaysia. In the 7th session, micro and nano machining process by Dr. eminent speaker Dr. L. Sujata, madam from REC. And the 8th session, Dr. Ananda Subramaniam in the topic BioMEMS for separation of cells, bioparticles using dielectrophoresis. 9th session, Microfluidics Technologies for Cell Isolation and Manipulation by our HOD, Dr. C. Muhammad Yusuf. The 10th session, Lab on Chip and Organ on a Chip Fabrications and Applications by Dr. T. Kali Kishore Reddy, Center for Bioseparation Technology from BIT Vellore. The 11th session, Fabrication and Characterization of Lab on Chip Devices in a Resource Constrained Environment by Dr. Somashekhar Bhatt from Manipal Institute of Technology, Manipal. In the 12th session, Nanotechnology meets Lab-on-Chip and Interface by Dr. Our dynamic speaker, Dr. Ashwin Kumar sir from, again, SRM University. In the 13th session, Design and Fabrication of Low-Cost Microfluidic Channel for Biomedical Application by eminent speaker, Dr. Asrul Nizam bin Abdul Munaf from University of Science, Malaysia. Again, the last session, Artificial Intelligence and Disruptive Technologies in Point-of-Care Application by our colleague, Mr. B.A. Muhammad Hashim. I think the program was a success in its objective of stimulating the research ideas to the participants and the faculty members. Now, I request our principal, Dr. Bhaskaran sir, to deliver the valedictory address to the participants. Bhaskaran sir? Bhaskaran sir, I request our principal. Yes, sir.
Good evening to all. First, I thank the our correspondent, chairman, and MMES trustee members of C. Abdul Hakim College of Engineering Technology, Mail Bishara. The HOD has today, for HOD, request me to address the validity address. In my own dictionary, what I feel is validity function means validate the victory and leaves some feelings to the, get some feeling and leave some feelings. This is what I had observed. But how to validate the whether it is the program is victory or not by collecting the feedback from the participants and resource persons. So far, we had a very good feedback from the participants. I think, I hope we have rights to organize the, conduct the validity function. Is it correct, I think? Yes, I think it's correct. Okay, but from the feedback mechanism, somebody told some noise and disturbance signal problem. Normally, this is a limitation of online program, I think. But in future, definitely we will overcome because the people, the program organized by only ECE department. Those peoples are well known about noise and disturbances and signal issues. In future, definitely we will solve those problems. So far, the past 5 days, we had a very good sessions about the biomims lab and tech for point of care of applications. The department of ECA utmost care they have taken to organize all the sessions and effectively, I think. I thank the resource person for sharing and supporting their knowledge during the last 5 days. I want to say something to the participants. So far, they had a very good sessions, but how to make use of it? That is, still we have to say is how to stand out among others. 100 participants are participated, but how to utilize this? How to stand out? The lecture is common for all 100 faculties, but how we have to come out, how I have to bring into something different. That is, we have to think different. Our former president Abdul Kalam also told that, that is, we dream it. We just dream it on the particular biomoms and lab and chip for point of care. You just dream it on, you think different, you create different, definitely you will get, definitely your something will be enhanced. Your, I think such a way to stand out among us. We in the way of presentation or we way of making papers, a way of delivering content to some other things. But the only problem is, only thing is, if you continue within a short period, only the participants, sorry, the participants and then resource person can able to, suppose to contact any issues and any something you want any help, they will help you. But if the distance, the time gap is long, but they may not help you sometimes. I wish you all the best for all the participants for make use of this program. Once again, thank the management and MME trust members for giving me an opportunity to deliver this validity address. And then before this, my special thanks to Dr. Muhammad Yusuf, HOD, ECE, and his team members for making this 5 days FD program grant. And then finally, I put a word to the AICT for giving this great opportunity to organize in this campus, Abdul Hakim College of Engineering. On behalf of the management and MME trust members, I thank the AICT for giving this opportunity. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, Principal sir. Thank you for your validatory speech. Now, in the final part of this session, to deliver the vote of thanks, I request Mr. Abdul Rahman from ECE department to deliver a vote of thanks.
Yes.
So India is among the countries that highest number of educational institutions and highest number of teachers and faculty members. This fact itself boosts the importance of events like this AICT-sponsored FDP program. So moreover, it demands a high level of individual and group effort from participants to draw this maximum learning benefit. So on behalf of the college management as well as the coordinator, first of all, my sincere thanks to Almighty for making this five-day FDP program a grand success. By His blessing and grace, we are able to make the event what it was. There is a small request from HOD. HOD want to have a small talk with the participant. Okay, so I am grateful to all the speakers who have joined us to deliver these research talks. And finally, no event will be successful without the participants. I thank all the participants who have been with us for this past 5 days in this ATEL-sponsored FDP program. So once again, on behalf of the management as well as the department, I congratulate and greet all the participants for the successful completion of this FDP program. Once again, I thank all the participants for being a part of this 5 days FDP program. So the session, along with the session 14 feedback will be posted in this chat group. Along with that, the quiz questions also will be posted in this Zoom chat. So I request the participants to give your 14 session feedback as well as the quiz link you can submit. Thank you. Thank you, participants.